No tribute to Donald Duck would be complete without a conversation with the man who's become not only Donald's voice, but pretty much his alter ego. Tony Anselmo, welcome and thanks for being here.
I'm sure I'm going to be here.
I've never been addressed by Donald Duck before.
How about that?
How did you come to study animation in the first place, and what led you to working with Jack Hanna?
Well, I always loved to draw. And I would write the animators, you know, Frank Thomas and Ollie Johnson and Jack, about what it took to be a Disney animator. And they would write back very generously with advice. So while I was in high school, I would take night classes in figure drawing and acting. And when I was 16, I had my portfolio together, and I came down and met with Ollie and Jack Hanna. And they looked at it and said, well, we'll send you to CalArts, which is where I went. Jack, who was the director of the Donald Duck unit under Walt, who also was an animator of Donald and a story guy before that, directed the animation program at California Institute of the Arts.
Specifically the character animation program,
correct,
right?
Disney character animation. And so I went there for 3 years.
There was a whole generation, it seems, of animation lovers, animation buffs, who wound up attending California Institute of the Arts. And around that time, I think a new breed of animator was hatched, if you will, at that school. Am I right?
Yeah, and there was a very small group of us. At that time, I remember telling people I wanted to be an animator, and they didn't know what that was. Now everybody wants to be an animator. Since The Little Mermaid, I think there's been a popularity of what animation is, and everybody wants to be a part of it. But before that, it was a very sort of a cultish thing, where there were very few of us that knew what Disney animation was and, you know, who those people were, the nine old men and California Institute of the Arts. So it was a very small group of us. There was 14 in my initial class. And when I started in at the studio, there were only 64 people in the animation department. So it really was a small family. And there was a camaraderie. We were all on the same page, as the goal was to do the finest personality character animation, you know, and carry on that legacy. That was, we weren't there for any other motive than to be a part of the magic. And as corny as it sounds, it was a very real thing. It was Camelot. As far as animation goes, you know, when you tell these stories, I don't think people believe it. But it was really, it was an amazing place.
So you were hired by the Walt Disney Studio.
Right.
At what level?
Well, they actually sent me to CalArts. They said, go there for 3 years, and then I was hired as an in-betweener, although I was put into a training thing that they don't really do anymore, where we were with Eric Larson and one of the nine old men, Ken O'Connor, Teehee, a lot of the Disney legends. We were in training before we were ever put on production once we got to the studio. This was after CalArts. So for 8 months, I was up in a room with other artists animating with Eric Larson. He would give us tests to do, and we would bring him, you know, we would work very hard to try and figure it out, and we would bring it into him, and he'd go, oh, just do this, you know.
Tell me a little about Jack Hanna. I had a wonderful correspondence with him and many phone calls, but I was living on the other coast at the time, so I never got to meet him. He was identified with Donald Duck for so many years at the studio. People who watch this disc will see his name as the director of many, many of those cartoons.
And started much earlier than that, because he started as an animator in the early 30s and a story man, mm-hmm. and then became a director in the 40s of the Donald Duck unit. He was a character, but he was like a father figure to me, because he really took care of me. He not only in just showing me the tricks of the trade and about Donald and animation, Disney animation, you know, I owed just about everything to him to getting into the studio. He was a kind of a rough and tumble kind of guy, and he had these catchphrases and things that he, you know, he kind of talked like this, and he, you know, they called it the duck. It wasn't Donald Duck. It was you got the duck there, and he comes around the corner, and he's got a cocky little walk, and he would work with a metronome and a stopwatch so that they could synchronize with the music better. It had everything had kind of a beat, whether it was Donald walking or him, his mannerisms would sync up with the music. So he always had a stopwatch, and he'd say, well, the duck will come down the stairs, hop, 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 you got a puff of dust, 5 seconds.
So far, your story, everything falls into place. You're an animation buff, student, lover, as a young man, you work on your art, you present a portfolio, you get accepted to the studio, you train as an animator. Where does the voice thing come in? How did you wind up at all being connected with doing Donald's voice?
Oh, it wasn't anything that I actually intended to do. But as I said, it really was a small family. Everybody knew everybody. And the first day I was on the lot, I was walking up Dopey Drive, and a man came down the steps of the animation building, 5'2", white hair, passed me, and he goes,
"Good morning."
And I, in a split second, I had never met him before, and I had never seen who did Donald's voice. So to hear that distinctive voice coming out of a man who I hadn't met before was shocking. But at the same moment, it was like, that's Donald Duck. It would have been like, you know, being at MGM and seeing Clark Gable. Mm-hmm. In fact, Walt called Donald the Gable of our stable because he was their main character. You know, he was the most popular character.
So that explains meeting Clarence Nash. What was the next step?
Well, over time, everyone was friends, and Clarence was a good friend. And doing voices and being the class clown, Donald was a voice that I couldn't do. And I asked him for fun, you know, how do you do that? And he showed me, and I couldn't do it. But I would practice from time to time, and any voice person will tell you the best place to practice is in the car or in the shower. And one day it kind of clicked in, and I thought, oh, I think that I did it.
Was it the car or the shower?
The car.
Okay. Just checking.
Yeah, it was the car. Mm-hmm. So I went, the next time I saw Clarence, I said, is this it? And he goes, yeah, that's it. But it was just the sound, and there's much more to it, you know, how to enunciate as much as possible. Mm-hmm. There are certain words you use, certain words you try not to use, or you use something that means the same thing to try and, you know, because...
What would be a tough word for Donald, for instance?
Well, it's funny. Sometimes big words like,
anti-disestablishmentarianism
is a long, big word, or
supercalifragilistic explanidosis
is pretty clear. But short words with R's or soft consonants like rules,
Why?
It won't come out.